Obviously, I mean, it's been bandied around the internet quite a bit, but if you shuffle the Olympics 2012 logo around, you can spell the word Zion.
Indeed.
And, there's a lot of stigma against the word, and, for no reason whatsoever. But obviously, Zion stands for the term New Jerusalem.
Yeah.
And this got me, having seen the Ian Crane speech and everything, this got me doing my, essentially, I had an urge to start my own research into this. I wanted to find out if what was saying could be proven, kind of thing.
Yeah.
And first thing that brought to my mind was the poem by William Blake. And William Blake wrote a poem in the 18th century called Jerusalem. And there's a paragraph, the final like few words in that poem says, "I will not cease from mental flight, nor shall my sword sleep in my hand, till we have built Jerusalem in England's green and pleasant land." So basically, William Blake was a known 18th century esotericist with connections to the Freemasons, and he was famous for such pieces of artwork as Your Eyes and the Creator, which
Yeah.
is a big picture of, like, kind of, the Creator with a compass opened up like a pyramid. Just like, Freemasonic symbology and stuff.
Didn't he reference the Newton in regards to that painting? Have you heard about that?
There is the Newton painting as well, and Newton is kind of on the, like, lurched over on the floor with his compass. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
That's
okay.
a different painting of William Blake.
It is okay,
But
yeah.
essentially, in that poem, we'd got an acknowledgement from a guy connected with esoteric research that they were intent on building Jerusalem in England's green and pleasant land. And so, we're thinking, like, when we talk about the Olympics 2012, we're talking about something that's been planned for hundreds of years, and there's a lot of proof that I've dug up that can show that. But basically, moving into the Olympics even further, after this talk, and when I got back from this talk in July last year, the first thing that happened was there was a video released by the Olympic Committee, and this was a stadium design video.
Welcome to the next stage in our journey to the Olympic and the Paralympic Games in London in 2012. And I will never tire of saying that. The Olympic spirit is about finding the best in ourselves. London 2012 will be that and more.
And here's this crazy CGI, I don't know what you want to call it, action film on how they're going to build the Olympic 2012 stadium. And given what Ian had spoke about with aliens and Independence Day style spaceships and stuff, this has got it all in it. Basically, within 40 seconds of this video, there's four chimneys that stand like an 11-11, but then it moves into the most significant symbology you could ever see with, like, an Independence Day style mothership for a roof, little UFOs flying all around the London Eye, and then
Right.
it ends up robotic streetwalkers in the middle of London stomping around the place, all like towards the Olympic Stadium. I mean, it's pretty weird to watch it, and it's on my blog, and it's on YouTube as well. If you just do a
Yeah.
search for the stadium design video, you can see for yourself that there's definitely symbology in there, like, whether you like it or not. This got me thinking. I was like, where does this go? Does this mean that there is a significant event looming for the Olympics? And I started thinking to myself, well, if they're about to do this now, they've done this before. They've used the Olympics for such events before,
Yeah.
which led me into looking into 1972 Olympics in Munich. Now, funnily enough, these were the world's first stage for global terrorism. The very first global, declared as global terrorism, the first act
Yeah.
was in the 1972 Munich Olympics.
Indeed, yeah.
And these Olympics, there were 11 Israelis killed, so we've got the number 11 there. And they were killed by a group called Black September, which is obviously the ninth month. So it's
Yeah.
obviously a 9/11 you've got there.
Yeah.
And that particular Olympics were host to 121 countries, which is 11 times 11. So you've got a significant event there with first, like, global stage for terrorism, as it is.
Yeah.
And then, moving on, I started thinking, well, the year 1984, there's obviously Olympics in that year. And it's synonymous with the George Orwell book of Big Brother, and, a completely, oppressive state, if you like, a new world
Indeed.
order kind of background.
Yeah.
And I'd heard, I've, I'd briefly remembered hearing things about a closing ceremony in the 1984 Olympics, and did some rooting around on the internet, and obviously came across a video. In the 1984 Olympics, which were held in Los Angeles, they closed the ceremony, and the audience didn't even expect this, because most of the audience thought it was real at the time. It closed with a UFO flying over the Olympic Stadium, kind of communicating with the audience in a Close Encounters of the Third Kind style. The UFO eventually closes down and lands in the center of the stadium.
The glow from behind the arena. The spaceship has actually landed. Will they send a messenger? The full moon over Los Angeles. That's the real one.
At which point there's a load of smoke. And then this alien gets out and tells the audience that he likes what he sees there.
He thinks we have a visitor.
The alien himself. That is no one on stilts. That is a man 7 feet 8 inches tall.
So you've got this really strange thing out of the middle of nowhere. No one was expecting it. And I don't know how you'd ever connect Olympics with this UFO event in the first place.
Yeah, yeah.
But basically, obviously, 1984, symbolic year, UFO landed. So you start thinking, stuff going on.
Yeah.
Not sure what. I can't really put my finger on things. And at this point, I'd decided to move away from the Olympics for a bit because I felt that, I wasn't going to find much more for the time being. And it got me involved in looking at symbols as such and general symbolism and corporate logos. And I started off with, obviously, the all-seeing eye on the dollar bill.
Yeah.
And if you notice with the all-seeing eye on the dollar bill, on the particular side that it's on, it's the only note that it appears on in America. And there's four ones on it, and they ring out 11-11 either side of the dollar bill.
Indeed, yeah.
You got the same thing again. And I was looking at that and basically started comparing it to other, American institutions, looking it through, the FBI logo, the CIA logo, every single one of them, you can essentially kind of draw out the pyramid without the capstone and have an eye in the center. The same geometrics work in a lot of the, the official institutions of America.
Yeah.
And I wanted to get to the source of where this was. And everyone, generally a misinterpretation is that America was the foundation of all of this, in 1776. For a while I thought America was the start of all of this New World Order stuff. I didn't think any further than that. My consciousness wouldn't allow it.
Yeah.
But eventually it came to me, Britain, obviously, the British founded America.
Yeah.
In a Western kind of empire sense, but looked at the British coat of arms, and if you pick up the British coat of arms, again you'll notice that you've got a pyramid, and where the all-seeing eye is, you've got a crown. It's the same thing. You can draw the same geometrics over it, and you've got smack bang the same symbols coming at you. So I was like, right, well, what's going on here? This is obviously a lot more ingrained in the human civilization, more than I thought, anyhow.
Indeed.
Which point you then start moving to the famous corporate symbols of McDonald's and Schweppes and Starbucks, these amazing corporations that you'll find them in all the symbolic places of the world. Like when I've been to Rome, you've got a McDonald's opposite the Pantheon and the Egyptian obelisk. And then if you go to the Sphinx in Cairo, and you've got a KFC and you've got a McDonald's right outside the entranceway.
Yeah.
And, literally everywhere you go, you can no doubt find one of these kind of food venues or whatever.
The pest.
Right next to some of these symbolic structures.
Yeah.
And so, for instance, explain the McDonald's logo. You've got 9 letters in the word McDonald's. And I decided to split that up into pyramid numerology. So you've got 1, 2, 3, 2, 1. Split the word up. Do you know what I mean? Into a step kind of structure.
And I think you have this on your blog, isn't that right? So people that are tuning in can take a look at that.
You can take a look at it on my blog, but basically, to spell it out, basically the two, you can form a pyramid-like word out of it in which the cornerstones and the top part of the pyramid minus the capstone spell the word Mason.
Yeah.
And essentially what the pyramid is showing is that the two arches of Freemasonry, or the golden arches, or whatever you want to call them, emanate from the centre of the pyramid and preside all the way onto the outside of the pyramid. So essentially you've got this event that seems to preside over the pyramid. And then same thing goes with the Schweppes logo. I mean, this, I had a real good 11-11 moment with this because it happened in a glass of Schweppes tonic water when the ice cube started ringing at me.
Right.
And I thought it was pretty mental, but cool. It was insinuating something was happening.
Nice.
And
nice.
I looked on the bottle, and the year 1783, obviously on the all-seeing eye, the date 1776.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, we're a bit too close for comfort here. We're in the period of the Enlightenment, is what they call it.
Yeah.
And look at their logo, and it doesn't even take any deciphering, this one. There's a pyramid with an angel on top, with a McDonald's-style M presiding over the pyramid. Mm. So essentially, you've got more messianic imagery in the logo of a corporate symbol. you know, and all I can think is this company, Schweppes, they teamed up with Cadbury's. They're instrumental in destroying the health of the world because they create sugary drinks and, you know, aspartame-ridden drinks and everything that goes with it. Sheesh. And they're using this symbology. So you can look at that on my blog yet again because it's all on there.
Very interesting.
Get to Starbucks. And Starbucks, if you look at, when you're walking past any old Starbucks, you'll notice that the logo is three stars that make a pyramid. And the very top star is seated on top of a crown, which is essentially, you know, symbolic of the all-seeing eye. But underneath the crown is a woman, and that woman is Isis, mm-hmm. so the Egyptian deity Isis.
Mm-hmm.
And essentially what I've realized over the past few days is that what these logos are depicting is some form of messianic event.
Yeah.
And when you look into a book, there's a book called The Secret Teachers of All Ages from 1928. By Manly P. Hall.
Indeed.
And states, Isis is sometimes shown standing between two great pillars of Freemasonry.
Yeah.
So deity Isis stands between these pillars. So on the McDonald's logo, where you've got the M and you've got the M coinciding on the top of the pyramid, and the same on the Schweppes logo, where you've got the angel stood on top of the pyramid, they're representing Isis. There's no other way of looking at it, in my personal opinion.
Yeah, yeah.
So basically, Isis is symbolic of the all-seeing eye. It's the same thing.
Hmm.
Same as when you're looking, for instance, into the Holy Trinity and stuff, and you've got the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
There's the evidence of the kind of, you know, the ever-looming one who sees everything but isn't quite there. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So anyhow, this stuff, this occult symbolism, it works on a dual level, you know, like optical illusions. For instance, you can now look at a picture and do you see the old woman or do you see the young woman?
Yeah.
It's got the duality, same as everything else when it comes down to religion.
Yeah.
Most people are attuned to see one thing, but it actually means another thing as well. But it depends which version you want to go with. There's two ways to look at it.
Mm.
And my opinion on everything with the occult is that it's working on a different plane outside of the five sense human reality. It's, you know, it's something that's working in the subconscious.
Yeah.
And going on that principle of mind before matter universe, when you're looking at this occult symbolism, and if one person is, say, looking at the Schweppes logo, and they're drinking Schweppes, and they're buying into this logo, they're buying into the brand, they're buying into all of it, they think they're just buying into a great drink, but they're also buying into this other thing, they're buying into this messianic event, and essentially, if you think about this mind before matter universe, if this stuff, this occult symbology is working on the subconscious, and it's working on the subconscious of a global population, then it's got the ability to still bring itself forward into matter. Do you know what I mean?
So it's what you're saying is that with the help of all these knowing people, so to speak, this is propelled forward. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, for instance, like when someone goes to a McDonald's and they're buying into the McDonald's, you know, how clever they got that anyhow.
Right.
But when they're going in and they're buying those McDonald's, they're also, you know, they're buying into the alternate thing, which is the symbol of, you know, this messianic event on top of a pyramid.
Hmm.
You know, it's empowering it. It's building it into the subconscious, and that subconscious can precipitate into matter at the right time.
And that's interesting, considering that many of these companies are so, I mean, they're global players. I mean, some of these companies have bigger, you know, a bigger economy and gain more money than certain countries do.
I mean, we've got no idea how they got so successful. I mean, you know, there's no reason for it, to be honest, apart from that there's something else there working with them.
Do you also think that, you know, potentially this could work the other way around, meaning that human beings, since we've been subjected to, at least in the Western world, you know, almost 1700 years of Christianity and so forth, that this, the reason also why they might want to pick a logo like this or you know, have this message in the logo is that on some level this speaks to our unconscious. So people who are inclined to, you know, lean towards the Christian faith, for instance, are actually in some way kind of lured in by these kinds of symbols and consequently they...
I mean,
yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the thing that I'll draw upon later is that how this, like, this works with more than just Christianity. Because if ISIS has many identifications, and she's got an identification as the angel Gabriel and the All-Seeing-Eye stuff.
Yeah.
But when we talk about this New World Order and the One World Religion and the One World Government, the angel Gabriel is the one figure that can unite Islam and Christianity, because both of them are dear to her as God's messenger.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're looking at implementing this New World Order, it's got to be something that combines these two religions. And that particular figure is that thing that can combine those religions. I'll touch on that in a bit, anyhow. It gets deeper. I'll be telling you all it is in a minute.
sure. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah. I'll give it a bit of time. I'll give you another 10 minutes.
Sounds good.
You know it is. But anyhow, moving back to the Olympics logo and the Zion logo and the 2012 and stuff. Basically, there's a little bit of research. There's stuff on the net about this as well. The company who created that logo is a company called Wally Owens and Wolf Owens. It's a brand agency, and this brand agency was set up by a chap called Wally Owens, and this man was responsible for branding corporate Europe. So basically, you know, GE Capital, all these logos that have kind of, you know, sunk into the subconscious of sorts. These are all like created by this man called Wally Owens, who created the 2012 logo as well. And it turns out his dad was a Freemason.
Nice.
So the chances are that, you know, there's an interview online where he references his dad trying to get him to be a Freemason. He never actually says whether he is or not, but the chances are it's in the family. And, you know, there's these messages in the logos that this man's produced. It's a Freemasonic branding, you know, company for corporate Europe.
Yeah. Wow.
Essentially.
Really interesting.
So,
I wanted the name there, Gail. Wally Owens, is that right?
Wally Owens.
Right, thank you. Okay.
WALLYOLINS.
Perfect, thank you.
Right, and so at this point, you know, you've got this connection to Freemasonry with the logo and stuff, and it moves much higher than Freemasonry. That's just like the outside protection for this stuff. I basically loaded up, you know, Google Earth, wanted to have a look at the London site from the air. I wanted to see, you know, what it is that's so special about this place.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it just so happened that the particular site in Stratford was the only last bit of wasteland that was, you know, that was left vacant in London. It was the one last place that they could do things for something like the Olympics. So, you know, it's quite lucky that they had it in the first place. And what I noticed was I started looking at the actual street plan of this place. And to go through it, you've got a number of roads that circle the site. And the first road is a road called the Eastern Cross Route. The East Cross Route, which is a reference to the Eastern Cross.
Hmm.
You know, the Eastern Cross is an Orthodox cross, and it's a modified version of the Patriarchal Cross. It's got two smaller cross beams across the side. Next road down, you've got Carpenter's Road, which encircles the site. Carpenter, who was a carpenter? Oh, good old Joseph.
Yeah,
he was
course.
A carpenter, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Next road down, you've got a road called the Great Eastern Road.
Mm.
And obviously when you refer to something as the Great Eastern, it's obviously like the Great Eastern Star. So you look into the Great Eastern Star, it turns out that the Order of the Eastern Star is the largest fraternal organization in the world that both men and women can join.
Yeah.
And it was founded by someone highly connected with the Freemasons. And their symbol is the pentagram. So this is the next road down.
Yeah.
Moving on around the Olympic site. If you envisage we're encapsulating the whole Olympic site here, the next road along is Angel Lane.
Mm.
And obviously the famous angel is the angel Gabriel.
Hmm.
So we've got Angel Lane here. Next road along, we've got Temple Mills Lane. Temple Mills, where the water mills belong to the Knights Templar.
Yeah.
So another connection there. The Knights Templar were the poor fellow soldiers of Christ in the Temple of Solomon. And then encapsulating all of this is Church Road. It's obviously another biblical road name.
Yeah.
So all the way around the Olympics 2012 site, which you could call Zion, if you go with the logo, is biblical road names surrounding the whole site. There's not one road name that's not biblical. So you start looking at that and you think, what the hell is going on? Because
yeah.
This site was supposedly a fluke that they found this. And, you know, what we're looking at is something that is clearly quite well planned. So if you move into, like, for instance, there's one road here that's called, is the East Cross Route is called the A12. It's another road name for it. And if I move into, say, for instance, hieroglyphics for a start, hieroglyphics, back in the days of ancient Egypt, they were seen as talismans in that a particular hieroglyphic didn't mean, like, one letter, like a H. It meant a multitude of emotions. It meant a multitude of meanings. And it basically, you know, it drew in the powers of the stars. That's what a hieroglyph was. It was a talisman.
Yeah.
It wasn't a direct translation. So, like, for instance, when they do a direct translation of the Rosetta Stone, you can't translate hieroglyphics into H, A's and Z's and stuff like that. Do you know what I mean?
Sure.
So basically, if you think of this idea of hieroglyphics as talismans, power of the stars embedded in this symbol, if you want to call it that, and then everyone assumes that the English language moved on from that, and that our letters just meant letters, just to spell words out, and that they weren't symbols at all. But the fact is that if you look into the idea that the power control in Egypt never died out, and they've been endemic to the power structure from the very start, the letters on the English alphabet are just as much hieroglyphs as the hieroglyphics were, the talismans.
I agree,
so
yeah.
If you look at the letter A, for instance, you've got a pyramid with a capstone, a capital letter A.
Yeah.
And then if you look at an S, you've got a snake. And then if you've got like a dollar sign, you've got a snake rising up what could be a kundalini or, you know, a DNA coil, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
But basically, these letters have got meanings behind them. And so this main road that cuts through the Olympics 2012 site, which is called the East Cross Road, is also known as the A12 Road.
Hmm.
Now, there's hundreds of A roads in Britain. And so what are the chances that of all the roads that cross through it were an A12 road, a Pyramid 12 road? Do you see where I'm coming from with
it? Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know, very interesting.
It's pretty strange that one road, you know, this is what I'm saying, coincidence is this load of rubbish that this is coincidence. It's not a coincidence whatsoever.
No.
And then you look into the situation of where it's situated in London and Eastern London, and you'll find that it's in two areas. It's separated between Leighton and Leytonstone.
Mm.
And I don't know if you're aware of what a ley line is, but basically...
Of course, yeah.
Yeah. If you look into this, the Olympic site is bang on where two ley lines cross over.
Hmm.
So we're on about something that's connected to the energy grid of, you know, the world, like the lifeblood of the earth, if you want to call it that.
Nice.
Interestingly enough, before when we commenced work on the Olympics 2012 site as well, I mean, I got this information off a chap on a message board, but he basically said that they'd organised a massive rave on the Olympic 2012 site, in which no doubt there's a lot of government-sponsored drugs out there. And a lot of energy being given off.
Oh,
and if you think about these energy lines, and they're inviting people to have raves on these sites, alongside holding some of the biggest like competitions in the world ever, think about what's happening with all that energy.
Oh,
where
of course.
Going? It's probably being fed into the system somewhere.
Hmm.
And I think that's. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, for instance, as far as UFOs are concerned and stuff like that, if you look into UFO sightings and stuff, a lot of them can be attributed to being near ley lines and stuff. Because obviously a UFO isn't necessarily something that's definitely fixed in our particular 3D world.
Hmm.
Something that could be obviously of another dimension of sorts.
Yeah.
But basically, like, you've got this Zion street map that's fully biblical in every way. And you then decide, well, I decided to pick up the Bible. I don't normally pick up the Bible. I'm not that type of person. But basically picked up and went to the book of Mark. And I decided to go to the... chapter 11, verse 11, you know, the old 11:11.
Yeah.
We got this passage here. Then Jesus went into Jerusalem and into the temple and looked around at everything. Since it was already late, he went out with his 12 disciples to Bethany. So we've got a mention of Jesus entering Jerusalem.
Yeah.
Which is obviously Zion's the new Jerusalem.
Mm.
And he says that since it was already late, he went out with his 12 disciples to Bethany. Right next to the Olympics 2012 site, down a Roman road, is a place called Bethnal Green. Right next to the Olympics 2012 site, down a Roman road, is a place called Bethnal Green.
Mm.
Bethnal Green, Bethany, sounds the same, pretty close, you know, not too far off.
Yeah.
Bethnal Green is 3.3 miles, 33 degrees, Masons and everything, 3.3 miles from Charing Cross, the centre of London.
Yeah.
So symbolic again, numerology and everything that goes with it.
Of course, I don't know if you've heard, but if we look at the research of Ralph Ellis, he talks that Mary Magdalene might have been Mary of Bethany. You know, there's a whole connection between Bethany and the family of Jesus, if you will, or you know.
Yeah, well, I mean, with the whole idea of the Dan Brown bloodline and the Priory of Sion and stuff like that.
Yeah.
That's I'll get onto that shortly, but that's all part of the plan. That's all part of what's intended here. They wanted to incite the public with the idea that there's a lost bloodline of Jesus Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is, pretty scary. Stop it off, but on a funny note, have you heard of EastEnders before?
Say it again.
EastEnders, the English soap opera.
No, I have not, no.
No, right, it's a popular thing that most of the, I'd say 90% of the population probably watch it, unfortunately.
Really?
It's those typical soap operas, and if you watch the intro sequence to that, basically behind the EastEnders logo, where, you know, on this intro sequence, is the Olympics 2012 site. So basically this thing that's making everyone forget about what's going on around them, that's distracting them, providing them with rubbish stories and terrible plot lines and everything,
yeah.
You know, stopping people from thinking, is symbolically showing this area on the TV screen every night of the week.
Interesting.
Quite
very
weird.
Interesting, yeah.
So, I mean, now I can get onto, I think I've set a good standing for this whole idea of Zion and this biblical event of sorts.
You know what I think we should do like this, Rick. I think that we should take a break right here, actually, because this has been basically an hour-long preface here, and you know, obviously I've got tons of questions and comments, but I definitely want to just let you kind of lay out what you have here, so to speak, and see where this leads us. So I'm going to ask you, Rick, to just basically continue on the trail that you ended in our first segment, if you will.
Okay. Right, well, obviously we've laid out a ground plan with a street map of, the Zion Olympics in 2012, like biblical road names left, right and centre, symbology and symbols and everything, you know, it's all over the place. So I sat down and I started thinking to myself, so what is going to happen? Obviously this is something that's clearly been in the making for, I mean, I'd presume that those roads have been like named them roads for over 100 years, because the street map hasn't changed in that time. And so what I started looking into was the idea of the Trinity, because obviously the pyramid numerology and everything gets involved in all of this, and you know, obviously I think there's a lot to be answered for in there. And so obviously the precession of the equinoxes is a 26,000-year cycle, in which a roughly 26,000-year cycle, and takes just over 2,000 years to transition into a new age. Obviously, 26,000 years through 12 signs of the zodiac, and that's about 2,100 for a new age.
Mm.
And obviously, with the dawn of Christianity under Jesus, we entered the age of Pisces, which was symbolized by a fish. And prior to that, under the age of Aries, we were symbolically represented with Moses and his ram's horn. So, you know, and we're reportedly moving into the 11th astrological sign of Aquarius, which is the water bearer. And so you start looking into religion as a whole, and you realize that every time that there's, you know, one of these kind of transition of the ages, if you want to call it that.
Yeah.
There's almost like a new Trinity event, which finds itself, you know, radically shaping the landscape. Mm. So, for instance, the last Trinity event we had essentially was the Jesus, Joseph, and Mary, who had been touched by the angel Gabriel. Trinity. And obviously in Christianity as a whole, you've got the Holy Trinity, which is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, which is symbolic again for the angel Gabriel. Hindu religion, we've got Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. The Jewish Trinity, which essentially not as personified, but was Moses, Ark of the Covenant, and the Temple. And then obviously moving into the human body, we've got the spirit, body, and soul. You know, we've got it all. But the fundamental trinity of the ages, like, that started it all was the Osiris, Isis, and Horus connection.
Yeah.
Obviously, Osiris and Isis, mother and father, giving birth to Horus, who was essentially personified, and it was the sun. But, so, given that we've got this 1776 on the Great Seal on the dollar bill, starting at 1776, we've got the Latin of Novus Ordo Seclorum. And it's literally Latin for New Order of the Ages. So it's not New World Order, it's what it's New World Order of the Ages. So it's obviously insinuating that it's to do with the transition of the equinox, like, of, you know, of the ages moving into the sign of Aquarius. And so I started thinking to myself, well, you know, if we're moving into this, we're going to have to expect new leaders. We're going to have to expect this new kind of, you know, forefront of religion that's going to come forward and, you know, save the planet as such. well, that's how they're going to, like, deal with it.
Sell it to us, yeah.
Yeah, are you going to sell it to us? Come on, give us your best shot. Basically, I started looking towards royalty because obviously, you know, royalty seems to be where it's at in the sense of the... You know, the coat of arms of Great Britain. It's on there. It's everywhere I look. It always leads me to royalty. It's a bit like, you know, David Icke's reptilian kind of stuff. Right, it always kind of leads to this weird thing, whatever you want to call it. And obviously, William is a symbolic person within, like, the continuation of the royal family and everything. But basically, I've nothing to go on at first, and I just had this real small whim. And I thought, Diana, is she going to be the personification of Isis? You know, is she going to be the next person to be identified with this god? And thinking it through, I was like, you know, quite probably not. But, you know, let's have a look anyhow. May as well have a look. And so basically, to just talk about Isis a little bit. Isis is a moon goddess, so symbolized by the moon. And she can be identified with the Greek god Artemis. She can be identified with the Roman god Diana and the angel Gabriel, which is the Holy Ghost. And she's always the third in the Trinity, you know, she's the apex of the pyramid. She's the all-seeing eye. And this is correlated, because if you watch, for instance, the film Constantine with Keanu Reeves, I only watched this the other week, but there's a scene in there where there's a particular actor who plays the angel Gabriel, and Keanu Reeves walks up to her and he says, "What have you been seeing with your all-seeing eye of late?"
"Yes, I spoke with the bishop."
"Yes. I know what you want, son."
"Still keeping your all-seeing eye on me." "I'm flattered."
Right. No one would pick up on that unless you knew what, you know, if you read this stuff, but it was there. You know, there was obviously the connection between the all-seeing eye and the angel Gabriel. So, out comes Google, as it does, and I started doing a search for Princess Diana and Isis. So the first thing I stumbled across... Princess Diana's perfume, her official perfume, is called Isis. So, it's like quite a good connection for a start. She's only got one official perfume and it's called Isis. So you start looking into things a bit more. And then you see that Princess Diana has got a memorial, which is a ring of water. And it's in the Serpentine, right next to Buckingham Palace in London. And I went down there to have a look at it and see if I could see anything else. But basically... this ring has east and west kind of flows of water, and the flow down this ring, and then at the other end, the conjoins, so east and west meet. So if you think of that symbology of east and west meeting, Islam and Christianity conjoining, do you know what I mean? The whole idea of unifying something into one. So there's the symbology of the unification of two extremes in this ring of water. But basically, if you look into Isis, she's identified with the Holy Ghost, as I've said, and the angel Gabriel. And now in the film, The Lord of the Rings, which is an esoteric piece of work by J.R.R. Tolkien, obviously everyone knows The Lord of the Rings because it's been put on the cinema screens, but there's a character in there called Galadriel. And if you look into the history of the character Galadriel, she was identified with the angel Gabriel. i.e. Mm-hmm. that's what she was, that's what mm-hmm. she's symbolic for.
Yeah.
And she was the wearer of a water ring. She controlled the water ring.
Mm.
So obviously you've got Princess Diana, water ring memorial, where East and West meet, combined with the Angel Gabriel in Lord of the Rings, or Galadriel, being the water ring bearer.
Mm.
So you've got this symbolic thing figuring, this symbolic, you know, this symbolism running throughout. So moving on to the next thing, how else can I identify Diana with Isis? And so you start looking into the Pont d'Alma, where she died, where she had a horrific car crash.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, there's stuff on the internet already that insinuates that the Pont d'Alma was a pagan sacrificial site.
Mm-hmm.
And it was used, like, ritually for hundreds of years, like, prior to, you know, the modernisation of the area.
Right.
Outside of the tunnel, we have a Flame of Liberty, which is in tribute to Diana's passing.
Yeah.
The Flame of Liberty, which is similar to the Olympic torch. Well, in fact, it is the Olympic torch. But if you think about the Flame of Liberty, and then you think to the Statue of Liberty in New York. The Statue of Liberty, I mean, Graham Hancock and Robert Bavall will all state that the Statue of Liberty in New York is symbolic for Isis.
Mm.
And outside where Diana died, you've got this, you know, Flame of Liberty statue, if you want to call it that.
Yeah.
And again, if you go back to the Secret Teachings of All Ages by Manly P. Hall, Isis carries with her the sacred fire religiously preserved and kept burning in a special temple by the Vestal Virgin. Mm. The fire is genuine, immortal flame of Isis. So, symbolically, what she's got outside the Pont d'Alma is a, you know, a connection to Isis yet again.
Mm.
So, moving on, I'd got wind of a tribute in Harrods, and this is where, obviously, do you know much about the Diana murder inquest and everything that goes with it?
You know, much of it, not all the details, but the overarching
right.
story is very familiar to me, yes.
Right, yeah, obviously there's the whole conspiracy, the idea that she was murdered, and Al-Fayed believed that she was murdered, and there's the fight with the royal family, essentially.
Yeah.
I mean, if you go to Harrods, and this is where it's proof that both sides are in on the same act, and this shows that this whole idea of the conspiracy of the murder of Princess Diana is all part of the intended stage play.
Mm.
That's been going on all along.
Mm.
In the Harrods, I went up to a woman and I said, where's the Princess Diana memorial? She went, oh, it's in the Egyptian staircase. So I was like, you're joking me. So I get led to this Egyptian staircase. And you go in, it's just real, I've been to Egypt and it's, you know, pretty much exactly the same as what you'd expect in Egypt. Real grand, golden looking, like, staircase with escalators in it and stuff like that. And loads uh-huh. of cheap perfumes, well, not cheap, really expensive perfumes on sale.
Yeah.
And you walk over to the shrine of Princess Diana and Dodi Al-Fayed, and you've got these two pictures. You've got, obviously, Diana and Dodi. Think about that. Christianity and you've got Islam.
Right.
And these two pictures are being symbolically held up by a dove. And the dove is also attributed to the Holy Ghost, which is the same thing as the Angel Gabriel and everything else that goes with it.
Mm.
So you've got symbology there. Below these two photographs, you've got a pyramid. Right, a 3D pyramid with a time glass in it. So symbolic to pyramids and time and stuff.
Yeah.
Then on either side of that, you've got two very tall candles, looking like a number 11 and also looking like the two pillars of Freemasonry that Isis is standing between.
Mm.
So what I'm hearing and proposing today is that essentially we have got Princess Diana being identified with the fertility god of Isis.
Hmm. Very right. interesting. Do you have, by the way, do you have taken any pictures of this memorial?
I've got photos of it. The problem I've got is I can't write enough in enough time because I work full time as well to
yeah.
get this all out. Do you know what I mean? It's such a big thing to write about. It's,
of course.
It requires a lot of time.
Yeah.
But basically, so you think about this, with the New World Order, they wanted a one world religion. We've got the combination of Christianity and Islam here symbolically in Harrods. Right, and obviously Islam and Christianity both accept the Angel Gabriel as a messenger of God.
Mm.
So we've got the proof here that they want to do this with Diana. They want to identify her with Isis.
Mm.
So what does that make Prince William? If Isis is, you know, the mother fertility god, that obviously means that William naturally becomes the son.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
So looking at this, I thought, right, we have to do a bit of research into William now. And, you know, 6 months ago, someone said that I was going to be researching the royal family. I'd have laughed my head off and said, you know, get away. It doesn't concern me whatsoever. But I've ended up being driven down this path and I'm it's doing my head in.
Yeah.
but anyhow, Prince William's birthday. He was born on June the 21st. You know when June the 21st is?
That's the summer solstice.
Yes.
Yeah.
So basically, you know, the Son of Most High.
Yep.
So in the New Testament, the angel Gabriel announced, "He shall be great, and he shall be called the Son of the Most High. The Holy which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God." Right?
Yeah.
So we've got Prince William's birthday, and it's on the solstice when the sun is most high.
Yeah.
Right? And then you look into it a bit further. How old is he in 2012?
Probably 33, right?
No, he's 30 years old.
30 years old, okay, yeah.
Connection here. Jesus began his ministry at age 30.
There you go, okay.
Right?
Yeah.
So you can't get away from this. It's all over these people.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so, symbolically, 30 years old, William's birthday, symbolically can be seen as an XXX in Roman numerology.
That's right, yeah.
And it just so happens the Olympics 2012 is XXX. So it's the same Olympiad.
Exactly. It's the 30th Games, 30th. Summer Olympic Games. Yeah, XXX.
Yeah. So, right, then you start thinking, you know what I was saying about, for instance, symbology and stuff like that, and you've got McDonald's and you've got Starbucks and you've got Schweppes, all like essentially occult symbology that's when people are buying into these things, they're subconsciously buying into this messianic event, you know, as I've stated before.
Yeah.
Well, if you think about this and the symbolism of the XXX, the triple X, think about what most single men do on the computers. I know it sounds crazy, but, you know, that's powerful energy that's being wasted there. This life-giving energy and, like, you know, they're symbolically buying into that triple X stuff. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, sure.
same as you've got the triple X film with Vin Diesel, in which he's seen as this heroic figure, and everyone went to the cinema and powered the triple X thing. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, this shows you how endemic this thing is, and like you know how crafty these things are.
Of course, and also I think it if you convert the alphanumerical number on an alphanumeric system from 1 to 9, then I think X becomes 6. So it's basically 666, right?
666. Well, I didn't know that, but that's good.
Yeah.
Right. So the next thing on, moving into William yet again, more stuff to do with him. It turned out a few months ago that he'd been made the 1,000th member of the Order of the Garter. Now, he's actually the 999th member of the Order of the Garter, but they changed it to 1,000 because of someone, you know, not being registered or something on the official log. But as you will know, the Order of the Garter is the parent organisation of Freemasonry.
Yeah.
Right. So if you think about that situation that we've got there, what are the chances that Prince William, if they hadn't pre-planned this, would happen to be the 1,000th member? I.e., you know, in the chronology of events, it just so happened that he was bang on the 1,000th member.
And that's also could be interpreted as the 1,000 points of light. So I don't know if you heard about that.
I don't know about that. No, that's new to me.
Okay, continue. Yeah.
Yeah, but do you know what I mean? It's quite a hard coincidence to fall upon that it'd be the 1,000th member in, you know, as it happens.
Of course.
But then go on further on again. Did you come across the Prince William received his wings news, all over Sky News and stuff recently? I don't know if you came across that. Basically, he's been in the RAF, he's been doing his duties, and there's all the RAF symbolism flying everywhere at the moment. They're trying to get everyone into the armed forces by giving everyone a bank holiday for Armed Forces Day, you know what I mean? let's keep the war going, guys.
Yeah.
But essentially, with the RAF, he said he received his wings. And if you look at the symbolism of the RAF wings and the RAF, basically, when you don't have your wings, the RAF is, the logo is the RAF in a, you know, a circle of... I can't remember the name for it, a wreath, like a circle wreath.
Okay, yeah.
So if you imagine that as the Egyptian sun disk for Horus, and then when all of a sudden they say he's got his wings, they put these wings on the RAF sun disk, and it makes it exactly the same as the Horus sun disk with wings.
There we go. Huh.
So, you know, the fact that they were pushing around the fact that he's got his wings,
yeah.
It was just symbolic for him saying that, you know, he's ascending into this thing, whatever you want to call this thing. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
But, I mean, here I am again saying that Prince William is, that, as I said, with the Dan Brown book and the Da Vinci Code and everything that goes with it, they're trying to get the masses to believe that there's a lost bloodline of Jesus Christ, and there might be. But what I'm saying is they're trying to get everyone to accept that. And so when Dan Brown's book, which was a terrible book written really badly, but obviously interesting story,
sure.
when everyone from, you know, like your 60-year-old woman who like doesn't get out much to your Benidorm crew or whatever in Spain, when they were all like running around reading this book going on about it, they were all having the seed implanted in their head that there's a lost bloodline to Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And you think about the idea of the Priory of Sion, this thing is all to do with the Sion Olympic Games.
Yeah.
It's all part of the same thing. But moving on, obviously the last thing symbolic with the Queen as well is that it's a Diamond Jubilee in 2012.
So
they're going to be,
really?
They're going to be, which is a lot of celebrations.
Yeah.
But moving on, moving on as always. Olympic bid 2012, the London Olympic bid. We received it and we received confirmation on July the 6th, 2005.
The International Olympic Committee has the honour of announcing that the Games of the 30th Olympiad in 2012 are awarded to the city of London.
The day after was the 7/7 bombings of London, but on that particular day, everyone, the news would have us believe, was full of like positive energy that Great Britain had won the Olympic Games. I mean, I think there's probably only about 2% who were bothered about it, but the media would obviously tell you that everyone was, you know, going out and getting drunk about it, but
yeah.
Essentially no.
Yeah.
But what they didn't tell you, and it's been covered up by the news, but it's on the internet, but it never got covered in News 24 or whoever, whatever you watch. Basically, on the same day that London bid was won for the Olympic Games, right, there was a huge, well, I don't know what you want to call it, massacre in the on the island of Haiti,
mm-hmm.
in which 24 people confirmed dead after more than 300 heavily armed UN troops carried out a major pre-dawn military raid in Cité Soleil. So, what happened was the UN troops, which is supposed to be a peacekeeping force, not something that goes out and actually, you know, does stakeout operations on drugs barons.
Yeah.
They did this pre-dawn military raid in which they killed 24 innocent people, right? And there's a lot of people looking into this. But what is symbolic is the place where it was. It was in Cité Soleil, which is Sun City, right?
Yeah.
Gets even weirder. It's one of the poorest communities in Haiti. It's one of the poorest communities in the Northern Hemisphere. It's got endemic AIDS, you know, poverty, everything. People are starving in this place because of the way that it's, you know, essentially it's been crippled by the power structure.
Yeah.
But basically, it's one of the poorest communities, as I've said, and it's in a place called Port-au-Prince. So it's Prince, Port, Sun City.
Mm.
On the same day the Olympic bid was won.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is that symbolically you've got Prince and Sun, and then you've got this thing that I've connected with Prince William. Was this another thing equally like buying into an event with such a negative, horrible event in which the UN massacred loads of people, 24 people?
Hmm.
Its symbolism is right through it, and it gets even worse because basically the UN Colonel Marino suggested that ballistic tests can be done on the dead, and he said records from the Medicine Without Borders shows an influx of civilian casualties starting at 11 a.m. The numbers are on the Wikipedia page, mm-hmm. so 11 a.m. brought in. And then you look into Port-au-Prince itself. Port-au-Prince celebrated its independence 200 years ago. I don't know what it celebrated its independence from, because it didn't seem to get any better. But
right.
The bicentennial monument that they erected in the independence of Port-au-Prince just so happens to be a pyramid without a capstone and an Olympic flame at the top.
Oh, nice.
So I don't know what that's saying, but you've got Sun City with a prince and you've got a pyramid with an Olympic flame on the same day the Olympics 2012 bid was won.
My God.
Doesn't happen. That doesn't happen. You know, it just doesn't happen. Too much stuff in there. So obviously getting into touchy areas and stuff here, because it's pretty dark, really, when you think about it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, moving into the Olympics 2008, I found this out recently. The 2008 logo, have you seen the Beijing 2008 with the little guy and his wobbly legs?
I've seen that, yes, yeah.
It doesn't look very much like an athlete, but, you know, given it's the Olympics and stuff. But it just so happens that if you decide to compartmentalize this logo into four different sections, it spells the word Zion.
Hmm, really now?
What are the chances that two Olympic logos in like two, you know, in succession, both can easily spell the word Zion without any form of trickery?
You know what? I'm looking at that as we speak here. I'm looking at your post about this, and that is incredible. Did you decipher that, or did you pick up that from somewhere else?
I just deciphered it the other day.
Wow.
Just having a look at it and just saw it, and I couldn't believe what I was looking at.
That's really interesting. I'm going to have this picture up on the website or link up this posting here of the blog so people can take a look at that. And that is really interesting. Wow.
Obviously, you've got slogan, One World, One Dream, for the Beijing 2008 Olympics. Doesn't that sound like a New World Order slogan to you?
Indeed.
Yeah. And so anyhow, this goes on further because there's more symbolism to do with the Olympics 2008.
Yeah.
Basically, on the 11th of November 2007, so that's 11-11, they released five mascots, right, for the Beijing Olympics.
Mm.
And these are weird little mascots that all got pyramid-style hats on. And essentially, each of these mascots correlates to a colour ring of the Olympic logo. You know, we've got the green, orange, red, black and blue rings.
Mm-hmm.
And each of the mascots correlate to one of these. They've all got their own colour. And essentially what you're looking at here is if you take it back to the main calendar and you've got the 26,000 year cycle, and essentially the Mayans believed that within that cycle there was five separate cycles of 5,150 years, something. Mm-hmm. I can't remember off the top of my head.
Yeah.
But basically they stated that at the end of each world, as particular one of the five elements destroyed that world and then created it again. You know, it restarted itself.
Indeed. So
there's like four destructions and moving into another cycle of sorts.
Yeah.
And I was looking at this, and there's one, the blue character, which is the last ring in the Olympic logo. The blue mm-hmm. character is symbolic for water. It's called Baby. It's a weird little critter. I don't know what you want to call it.
Yeah.
But it's symbolic for water, strong in water spots, and she reflects the blue Olympic ring. And this is the only of the five characters that's got a spiritual third eye.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, why has this got a spiritual third eye? And then you think about this Diana's ring of water, and then you think about this spiritual third eye in the mascot, and you think of water obviously is symbolic for Aquarius. There's this idea that we're moving into this blue ring of the Olympics, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
I mean, to explain this better, those Olympic rings for me are the five cycles of time from the main calendar. Only one's connected to another. And it's almost like there's the transition stage where the two rings meet up.
Hmm.
If you understand what I'm trying to
yeah,
say.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Yeah.
And so when, for instance, you've got a film, set of films like by J.R. Tolkien, the Lord of the Rings, what it really means is the Lord of the Cycles of Time.
Mm, yeah.
Right. And so then when you think about the trilogy, you had the Fellowship of the Ring, which incidentally opens up with Gandalf's birthday on the 111th birthday, 111, which is obviously a pyramid number.
Mm-hmm.
Got Fellowship of the Ring moving into the Two Towers. Sounds symbolic to World Trade Center, if you like.
Yeah.
Moving into Return of the King. Same thing. They're on about buying us into another messianic prophecy.
Hmm.
So, do you know what I'm saying about this symbolically ring cycle thing? It's all basically insinuating that throughout the cycles of time,
yeah,
something has had control of everything. And what I'm trying to propose is that when, for instance, in Egypt, they pretty much know that the Grand Pyramid, the Great Pyramid, started fully formed as such, and then the Egyptian civilization went into decline from there and after.
Mm-hmm.
All the pyramids that followed it were in like disrepair. They don't stand the test of time, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And obviously, everyone believes that before that, there was obviously the Great Flood of sorts, the Great Flood, which essentially came after the destruction of Atlantis.
Hmm.
So what I don't know too much about Atlantis myself, except it's supposed to be a highly technological, like, you know, civilization of sorts.
Indeed.
But if you think about these cycles of time, Atlantis was destroyed. The same power structure, whatever, managed to survive it anyhow because they had the technology to survive it, and then they restarted again straight with the pyramid back into the next cycle.
Well, there you go, and I think that's an extremely interesting point because to some extent we can say that we are in kind of that technological advancement, as it were, right now, and we're also kind of approaching it. It's the speed up of the thing, and it's like, you know, we're going to be like at the peak of our, you know, civilization, as it were, whatever, you know, we want to call it. And I think at, you know, basically at the same time as everything is, you know, the technological singularity, call it what you will, this kind of the high point of our achievement, at the same time that we actually reach that pinnacle, we could potentially also kind of fall again, so to speak. And this could be a moment, and this could, might, you know, where will we be around 2012? I don't know.
Well, I can take this now after this. I mean, I've covered the cycles. I could pretty much tell you what the religion of the New World Order is as well.
Okay.
if you want to know that.
I'd love to. Yeah, share with us, please.
Basically, if you're reading Revelations, chapter 11, verse 12. Now, a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet. Remember the moon, because that's symbolized with Isis. Mm. And on her head, a garland of 12 stars, like the 12 stars of the EU flag. Yeah. But basically, in Revelations, it refers to the breaking of the seven seals.
Mm-hmm.
Right. In the Mayan prophecies for Chilam, a high priest, in 1560, there was a prophecy written about the arrival of Christianity and the arrival, you know, this was like the end of the Mayan calendar prophecies of sorts. And he said, there the masters of our souls arrived. There the counties were distributed to their chiefs. There we began to learn the holy faith. There water began to enter our heads. There were laid the foundations of the high church, the palace of God. There the principle of the seven sacraments were founded. So seven again, seven seals in Revelation, seven sacraments in the main prophecies.
Mm.
And I do Reiki, so I know what the seven of, and the seven chakras.
Mm.
Seven sacraments, seven chakras, same word, same thing to me.
Yeah.
And as a confirmation of that, on my blog, there's some more deciphering of imagery. And if you have an issue of the UK passport from 1998, I think that's when mine was issued.
Mm-hmm.
There's an image of the rose, the thistle, and the daffodil, which are the flowers of England, Scotland, and Wales.
Mm-hmm.
But as I've said, these images have two meanings, and they have two, you know, they have a duality. And this image that no one knows what it is, it's on a page called Reserved for Observations Only, with a number 11 on the page. It's basically showing a diagram of the chakra system. And you can correlate that, because basically the heart chakra lines up with an image of a heart, and the solar plexus chakra aligns up with an image of a sun. So basically you've got this thing, but even more concerning, or not concerning, on the root chakra and the crown chakra, it's signed with a inverted pentagram.
Mm-hmm. Really?
So you think about that, there's an inverted pentagram on your crown chakra and your root chakra.
Hmm.
Now, I don't know what that's symbolically saying, but it's obviously involving spiritualism.
Yeah.
And if this is in the UK passport, I mean, it's beyond me that our government have ever acknowledged the chakras. I've never known that in my entire life.
Yeah.
But as a further proof to the New World Order religion is going to be based on spirituality, the Tibetan flag. I don't know if you've seen this. I've recently picked this up myself because of all the kerfuffle with the Olympic torch and the Dalai Lama and everything. Basically, it's become pretty apparent that the Free Tibet movement was funded by the CIA.
Hmm.
You know, because you know, it was a way to, you know, it was a way to rise up against China. But essentially, like, ignoring that, if you look at the Tibetan Buddhist flag, or the Tibetan flag that they used from 1912 to 1950, which is banned by China now, if you look at that, it depicts what is a mountain, but it's not a mountain, it's a pyramid. Mm-hmm. And at the top of the pyramid is a sun, right? Mm-hmm. So essentially you've got a pyramid with an all-seeing eye on the banned Tibetan flag that the Tibetan Buddhists used to represent themselves. So what is that saying about Tibet in 1912 to 1950 when they used that flag? It's almost like it's a blueprint for, you know, the New World Order's religion of sorts, so I'm based on meditation, spirituality, chakras, and, you know, all that goes with it.
I mean, I'm looking at a picture of the Tibetan flag right now, and even the fact that they have, there's two, you know, lions, if you will, that is holding up the eternal flame, and even the word itself, if you look at pyramidion or pyramidos, I should say. That's basically fire in the middle. So, I mean,
yeah,
they give you the hint right there that this is a pyramid, and then you have the sun in the backdrop. I mean, it's incredible.
Yeah, you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, of course, yeah. So
so you've got this thing, and I've got a recent picture of the Dalai Lama sat giving a press conference, and his head was aligned perfectly with the back of that sun. And this is where I'm moving to some weird stuff, because obviously this new world order religion is basically still sun worship, but it's based on spiritual sun worship. It's going to combine Islam and Christianity. And it's through the emergence of ISIS and the resurrection of a sun god. This is how it's going to happen.
Yeah.
But the thing is, obviously, New Age talk, conspiracy theories, and all of this stuff that's put out there, these are low-level distractions and stuff. And obviously, the New Age spirituality movement, it's not a bad thing in itself, but essentially, if you look at where it probably started from, it probably started from something very different to what we expect. Do you know what I mean? This whole moving into the age of Aquarius and the whole new age stuff.
Well, of course. I mean, I mean, from my point of view, at least at this point, from what I've picked up on so far, this is the reason also for why they are reverting back to all of these, esoteric, some would say even pagan, if they come from a Christian background, what have you. But the reason for it is that I think that there is a spiritual truth in many of the methods, so to speak, that they actually use to control people, meaning that there actually is something real to this. But and they have known this for a very long time, but they consequently manipulate people in the other direction and consequently say that, that's all bollocks, don't look at that. We have your religion right here for you. We call it Christianity, what have you. And I consider many of the real religions that we have around today basically is a reformation from the oldest ancient religions, going back to the ancient world of Cana, Egypt, what have you, and it doesn't matter in what package they sell it to us. If you're smart enough, you're going to be able to see through that. If you're clouded by too much of the manipulation, that's unfortunate, but in many cases it's people's own choice, and I have nothing against that either,
Of course you can't dictate that at all, can you?
No.
Essentially, like, the thing that I'm trying to, like, to get across, what I'm trying to say, I mean, I'm moving to an area that Matthew Deleuze touches on. I think you've spoke to Matthew Deleuze before. But essentially, for me, the power structure that remained in power, or that started, something that built the pyramid, that got the people to build the pyramid, was a very powerful force. And in the history of, well, I've got a particular book called The Secret History of the World by Jonathan Black. It's an esoteric secret history of the world. And this particular book states how that since, the early days, we're getting more and more ingrained in matter. We're moving, like, everyone thinks of evolution in a material sense, but consciousness has equally gone through an evolution, moving from the spirit drawing itself down into material matter over time. And so, for instance, when you listen to the Egyptian stories of Zeptepi the first time, in the state that the gods ruled the earth, and then the gods retracted, so they built statues, effigies for people to worship to. And then eventually, after the gods had retracted so much, the pharaohs then ruled the earth for the gods, or ruled Egypt for the gods. And then, essentially, went from statue worship to idol worship into what we're currently at. We're at celebrity star worship,
pop idols. Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? It's the same thing. Madonna, all this lot. It's all part of the same thing.
Well, exactly. Continue.
But my thing is that obviously the Egyptian power structure that was in place then has never died out. Because if you look at the way the power structure has moved, like essentially when Egypt collapsed, you had the Exodus with Moses and stuff into the area of Israel and Palestine, And then the next major power structure was essentially with Rome. And if you go to Rome, you'll notice that there's Egyptian obelisks. In front of the Vatican, in front of the Pantheon and stuff like that. They carried those things over there from Egypt.
Yeah.
And then, obviously, the Roman Catholics went on the Inquisition, slaughtering out any heretical-like religions, such as like the Cathars and the Bogomils, moved through Europe, and then essentially found a new power structure to erect in Paris. And obviously Paris has got, you know, it's symbolic for Parisis, it's already in the word.
Yeah.
But Paris, you know, they moved the obelisks and stuff, Place de la Concorde on the, you know, the Champs-Élysées alignment.
Yeah.
you got that whole symbolic area. And like when I went there the other day, incidentally, I went to the front of the Louvre, and they've got a aerial viewpoint of the layout of the Louvre, and it's an exact replica of Luxor Temple with the Avenue of Sphinxes running to Karnak Temple in Egypt, because I've been to the same place and I've recognised this. But there's no official statement anywhere that the Louvre is based on Egyptian temples and alignments and stuff, but it is, obviously.
Of course.
So this power structure, then once it had done in Paris, it decided that, you know, this it wanted to find the new like centre of power, and it moved to London. And if you go to London, they've got an obelisk and stuff like that. You've got Big Ben. The official story is that Big Ben was named after this politician named Ben, who stood up in Parliament and said, "Oh, let's call it Big Ben," and everyone laughed and said yes.
Yeah.
But it's not called Big Ben because of that. It's named after the Ben Stone, which is like, you know, one of the very first, you know, it's stands proud in Egyptian, you know, history.
Of course, and even in Hebrew, Ben is the son of someone, so it's the big son.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, so the Big Ben, for instance, is a huge obelisk-type structure right near the obelisk and the London Eye, which is symbolic, again, for the all-seeing eye.
Oh, I know,
And then, obviously, this power structure moved from London to America. And then there we have it. America has been used as an excuse to run all these wars that it's needed to run until it's collapsed itself into the ground, and then America will die. And that's how I see it. America's been used, essentially. And they've used the people there.
And that's also an interesting point. I mean, there's so much to touch upon on that, but just to be brief about it, even the fact that I think that they want that if we talk about America as an experiment, if you will, and much in the same way that we can look at the Soviet Russia as an experiment, but or you know, communist, you know, Russia, but they might have wanted a certain kind of stock, if you will, of people or a certain type of breed, those who were willing to you know, draw out their roots from their own country and just leave and have a certain type of mentality. And if you take all these different things into account, you end up with a really interesting picture that potentially is showing you that what you're mentioning here, that they wanted to use America for a specific purpose. But anyway, please continue. Yeah.
I mean, obviously, if we're going on this premise that this power structure has been there and it's never died out and stuff, and then obviously you start looking at the English words and the language and stuff like that, and we're all connecting back to this idea of Sion, and then you start thinking, essentially, with English words, as I've said, you've got the word television, Televi Sion.
Yeah.
So basically, you know, everyone thinks the television is an evil hypnotic machine anyhow, I mean, other than the ones who enjoy it.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's there to televise Sion.
Yeah.
And then you think of the word spiritual ascension, spiritual ascend Sion. It's the same, it's in the words of what we use.
Yeah.
Like, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's endemic and it's there, you can't get away from it.
Of course. Vision or eye Sion, that's even the eye in there, you know, because it has to do with visualization or to see see something, you know, so.
Yeah. Mm. But this is, this is where, like, I can start to, like, wrap this thing up slightly.
Yeah.
Is that if you look at it, it starts becoming apparent that it's more to do with just like, for instance, it's more to do than just someone hijacking a power structure and keeping it like in control. It's almost like it's, you know, to do with material reality itself.
Mm-hmm.
It starts to feel like that it's coming from something that's, you know, if you think of us as souls and spirits trapped in matter, then like this is where I'm starting to like perceive things, in the sense of, if you look at all religious figures throughout history, every single one of these illuminated, enlightened figures, every single one of them has a sun behind their heads.
Yeah.
Right, so sun worship, again.
Yeah.
And Christmas, for instance, you can't get away from Christmas. I mean, Matthew Deleuze talks about this stuff, and I recommend listening to Matthew Deleuze because he's a very intelligent man and he's a very, very special man. But Christmas, obviously, we're all driven into this worship of the sun at Christmas. You can't get away from it if you've got kids or if you're related to kids. You need to be part of it. Mm. You know, we all buy into this Christmas thing. Christmas is sun worship. If you look at the tree that you've got in your living room, you know, it's like the tinsel is a serpent. You've got an all-seeing eye at the top. You've got a bloody pagan tree, you know, pyramid thing that's sat in the corner of your room.
Yeah.
And then Easter, obviously, again, it's more sun worship. And when kids, for instance, are all wanting the Easter eggs and stuff, it's nothing to do with the fact they're eating chocolate. They're buying into a ritual.
Mm.
They're buying into more sun worship, whether you look at it or not.
Yeah.
And the same goes with, like, for instance, crematoriums that haven't got any kind of religion tied to them. If you look at crematoriums, there's sun symbolism at crematoriums. You look at number 10 Downing Street, above the number 10, there's a sun symbol, like above the, you know, the centre of where our Prime Minister resides. You look at Shell Petrol, and it's sun symbolism. You know, and then, for instance, something I found the other day, my UK driving licence, there's a hologram you can barely see, but I shone it in the light. It's a sun and a pyramid on my driving license in Britain.
Yeah.
You know, something you'd expect on the dollar bill. And so all I can say is that essentially with this symbolism, when people don't realise what they're looking at and what they're buying into, this stuff is like taking spiritual energy away from them. It's, you know, they don't realise what it's doing. I don't know how to really put that into words, but it's like, we've only got our five senses, and like we're aware of everything within those five senses. But much like with the, you know, the light spectrum, we're not aware of what microwaves and X-rays and infrared rays and everything are doing. There's stuff we don't understand, and like our five senses are a filter.
Yeah.
And it's almost like that these symbols that have all been like fed with energy from, you know, if it was like a talisman, like they feed the energy from the stars in ancient Egypt. That's how they used to do it. It's working on some level we can't comprehend, that's, you know, basically trapping and deceiving us here all the time.
Yeah.
And so, for instance, in my opinion, when you die and you get these references to people saying, I met Jesus and all this kind of stuff, and they tell you that they met these enlightened beings and everything,
yeah,
because they're so familiar with the symbolism, because they haven't asked what it's all about or anything like that, it's almost like if you, for instance, meet Jesus when you die and you go with him, and he'll tell you you can be a lawyer next time and he'll send you back around again.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? It's like you're encapsulated in this, as the Tibetans believe, and Tibetan is the New World Order religion in my opinion, they believe in reincarnation. And so the reason why the reincarnation happens is if you're still duped by this symbolism when you go through. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You need to be able to stop, like, you know, believing that this symbolism is here to help you, because it's not. And my opinion is that what's going on is this material reality, whatever we're relating, it's most like the Gnostics believed, and in the sense of the Gnostics believed that there was a creator of the material universe, but they never ever, like, you know, saw their creator as the supreme being or the god, if you like. The creator was a malevolent force of sorts, keeping us all entrapped in this matter, preventing us from being what we really are. And like the Gnostics used to say, when they died and they met the creator, they used to say, you know, you're not my god, I'm a Gnostic.
Mm.
And essentially that's when they believed that they had moved on from everything.
Mm.
And it's almost like it's the same principle. I mean, they tried to wipe out the Gnostics, did the Roman Catholics, but it's the same principle. Like, people are... When this spiritual event happens in 2012, if this spiritual event happens, the obelisks and the pyramids and the symbolism will still be around everywhere. Do you know what I mean? Everyone might be ascended in a spiritual fashion and know about the seven chakras and stuff like that, but you're still going to be feeding your energy into the same machine.
Of course. What you're talking about here, as far as I can pick up on here, is that you're talking about that you need to become... smart, or you need to be able to interpret all of the symbols and what it does to you. Not only that, you know, okay, we have sun symbolism everywhere, very good, but what actually does it mean? Where does it lead you, and so forth? And in what way are they using it on us? Because in many cases, I can also see that I mean, if we look at how nature operates, how it exists, how the functions of nature occur, we can understand that the sun, for instance, is one of the most important elements that we have in order to sustain us, keep us alive. So obviously one can understand that there is a veneration for the sun. But how is this being used? And I mean, what you're referring to here also, as far as I can pick up on it, is a little bit of the Buddhist ideology or theme that we actually are trapped in a kind of illusion, if you will, or the wheel of reincarnation, and that this is something that actually is a trap. To some extent, I don't agree with that idea a little bit, but I understand what you're saying and how a philosophy like that can arise.
If you think about, say, for instance, the film The Matrix, The Matrix had Neo, which is an anagram for the One, had Trinity, had Sion in there, had the whole thing in there.
Of course,
And for instance, when Neo had decided that he wanted to know the truth, and he was no longer wanting to be kept in this illusion, and Morpheus offered him the blue or the red pill, and he took the one to see the truth, obviously. When he woke up, there's a little robot that came up, a machine that came up and looked at him.
Mm.
And then the machine just looked at him and then shot off, right?
Yeah.
And you think to yourself, why didn't that machine attack him? And the reason why that machine didn't attack him is because Neo, in the film, basically had seen through everything. He knew the truth and no longer could provide energy for the machines in that pod. Basically, I've got this kind of feeling that as we're approaching 2012, we're obviously approaching some kind of new cosmological energy of some sort.
Yeah.
You know, something involving the universe, which we're probably far too great for any of us to really comprehend at the moment. But working on the mind before matter, like idea. Basically, I envisage what's going on as we're moving closer to this date and we're getting closer to this energy all the time.
Mm.
Manifestation time between kind of, you know, thoughts and manifestation creating themselves into matter is getting shorter.
Because we are being drawn toward the attractor through shorter and shorter epochs. And not only must the entire last 4,000 years of history be compressed into this 67-year period from 1945 to 2012, but there is a 384-day period preceding December 22nd, 2012, when the last 67 years and the last 4,300 years have to be compressed into that. Then there's a final six-day period when all of these things are compressed again. And so do you see what's happening? The spiral is tightening as it goes faster and faster. The resonances are impinging. The thing is getting nuttier and nuttier and nuttier as computers link all cultures together, all informational barriers dissolve. Everything is becoming connected to everything else. Not only everything in the present moment, but all past moments as well are being drawn, compressed, squeezed toward the production of the transcendental object at the end of time, which is nothing less than all time, all space, shrunk down to an atomic dimension and handed back to us.
So do you understand what I'm saying? The spirit, the gap between consciousness and our material bodies are closing up, and so eventually we'll be able to create our reality a lot quicker than we currently do.
Mm.
If you look at what's going on, for instance, in Indiana Jones, the symbology all over that film for 2012, there's the Mayan calendar. They don't acknowledge it, but he's rocking on the Mayan calendar in that film.
Mm.
There's loads of other stuff that coincide with the Mayan prophecies and stuff. And the same goes is like when I was on my trip down to Paris the other week, and I was driving down the M1 in Britain, and the first motorway service station I got to, I walked to the shop, and I went in there, and there's this big pile of books on offer, and the books that they sell in motorway service stations are terrible. They never give you any knowledge whatsoever, not good for anything, but there's this one book on offer. And I went over to it, and it was a book all about the end of the world in 2012 on the main motorway of like Britain's motorway in one of the shops, one of the main shops that you get on the service stations. And I've got this feeling that what's going on as we're getting close to this energy and as we're getting this gap between kind of thought and, you know, manifestation of matter is getting shorter. There's a particular force out there that's trying to implicate that 2012 is going to be a huge disaster. And for instance, next year, the man who released Stargate and Independence Day is releasing the film 2012.
Yeah,
and it's going to be the biggest disaster movie on record, going for $200 million.
You know,
there's plenty of starving people in the world, but we can spend $200 million on this film.
Oh, of course, no problem. And
what this film is going to perpetrate, and everyone on the bloody planet is going to know about 2012 for being a disaster. So if what I'm saying is this idea of a mind before matter situation, if the general population are all believing that 2012 is going to come around and it's going to be a disaster, our consciousness could end up manifesting that for us. And the problem we've got is obviously that the people in power have the technological, like, well, the technology to survive such a thing, and the general population don't. So it's all about the manifestation of a disaster that they're trying to swing their way by putting out this information to the public.
Do you understand what I'm saying? Of course. One quick question there is, if they're at the same time are trying to put Prince William up as the new messiah, if you will,
are they
at the same time also trying to destroy everything that they are building up here then around 2012?
Well, the interpretation I've got is that in between this 2008 and 2012, because obviously the two logos contain the word Zion, there's going to be a lot of things happening between those 4 years. We're not just going to end up with one event. It's going to be a sequence of events continually.
Yeah.
And I believe for anyone to be implemented as king of the world, which I think they're aiming for, you know, you're going to have to touch, like, you're going to have to touch people, and those people are going to be, they're going to have to have been stretched. Do you know what I mean? They're going to have to be on an emotional knife edge to believe everything that they're seeing.
Yeah.
That's all I can say, is that I do believe that in the run-up, like, for instance, when you've got Prince Charles beaming himself into the EU via holographic technology.
Yeah, there we go.
And stating stuff along the lines of that he knows for a fact that in 18 months' time we're going to have a sequence of mega disasters all around the world. How does that man know that that is going to happen?
Did he say that?
Yeah, he did say it. What? He said it about 2 weeks ago.
Really or no?
Yeah, do a search for Prince Charles, natural disasters, 18 months, and you'll probably find it straight away.
Okay, I will do that. That's very interesting. Okay.
How does this man know that? Do you know what I mean? It's scary.
Well, he's at the potentially at the top of the pyramid, you know? Who knows?
He's a Zyrus, isn't he?
Well, exactly. There you go. Exactly. He is. No, I mean, this is... There's so many people also that have been looking at Prince William and that come from this from a different angle and so forth. I definitely see that there's something there. I mean, there's incredible stuff going on the symbolical level. And yet I always try to, or rather I kind of move back towards the other perspective of that. Okay, is this something, is there an archetypal image within civilization of man that right now always kind of strive for the Trinity, and whatever people that are in a position to represent this Trinity are going to be put forth as such, and those who are you know, smart enough to pick up on this can see it. Or is this a totally manipulated thing from day one, you know, going in, this is what we're going to do, and this is where everything leads? What do you think about that?
As far as I'm concerned, you know, we never really chose our royal family. So as far as like people pushing these forwards as these archetypes, I don't see that, because they seem to have you know, claimed this land without any real justification.
Of course.
So I perceive this as something that's being hijacked.
You know what?
I mean, obviously, all of this could be at the very least just my creative brain coming up with a brilliant story.
I agree with you on one level. I always keep the other door open, but that doesn't mean that I reject either one of the theories. You know, I'm totally forward with what you're saying here. I mean, it's I totally agree. It's I mean, it's incredible when you think about it. You know what? I want to do like this. I want to give you a proposition here, so to speak. I want to have you back on the program, and because we actually have gone through basically 2 hours now, I think that this is a good amount of information for this time. So what do you say, Rik? Are we up for a part two here in a while?
Yeah, that's fine. No worries. I'm up for that.
Okay, great. Because there's so much more to talk about. But okay, let's begin to round things up here, because this has been very interesting, and I think that what you managed to do here also in a way is to kind of take a lot of the material that is out there. You know, there's basically, this is the grand, you know, idea of what is happening in, you know, within one perspective. If you collectively bring in a lot of different research, I don't know how you have come up with a lot of these answers, but I'm certainly familiar with a lot of the concept that you present, and this, I would reckon, at least, are building upon other people's research, like, you know, everyone from Jordan Maxwell to, you know, as you said, Manny P. Hall, to Graham Hancock, to Matthew Deleuze, to, you know, there's tons of people out there, right?
Yeah. I don't know the first name that he presented, but Graham Hancock, Matthew Deleuze, obviously Ian Crane, and just, yeah, general reading, Daniel Pinchbeck and stuff.
Of course,
but
I mean,
it's a culmination of everything, isn't it? It's the way we're all working, we're building up on each other.
Exactly, that's right. It's a convergence of information. I must mention, the reason I mentioned Jordan Maxwell, the name that you didn't recognize, is that a lot of his research is featured in Zeitgeist, and unfortunately, they didn't even mention his name once in that film. No, they've had over 2 million viewers. I mean, so probably more so far. And if they just even would pop out his name there, I would be so much more happier. It's a personal hero of mine, and you know, research write up the name Jordan Maxwell and take a look at some of the videos that you're gonna find on Video Google and stuff like that, because it's brilliant research there, you know. So. We will talk more soon, and we'll stay with me here, Rik, and we'll talk more off air, okay?
Okay, cool, Brian.
Thank you very much for joining us.
Welcome to the next stage in our journey to the Olympic and the Paralympic Games in London in 2012. And I will never tire of saying that. The Olympic spirit is about finding the best in ourselves. London 2012 will be that and more.